we're live streaming this all over the state, and Mrs. Hurley and I went to Utah for lunch a couple weeks ago and met one of the top school leaders there, and they want this in Utah and Idaho next, so we're slowly, and I'm not even trying, I think people are just figuring out that if you want STEM and aerospace and leadership and character, we're kind of it. And part of the success team here is General Steve Lorenz, who I get to introduce here. And I'm assuming everybody knows me. I'm Mark Hyatt. I founded this AeroLab 5 years ago, and it's because I got bored in retirement, and then I just grabbed all my Falcon brothers and sisters, and guess what? 5 years later, we've gone from 14 kids to over 600, and we've already got 700 signed up for next semester, and it just keeps growing. It's not rocket science. But I'm the B student that knows all the A-plus students. And I know he doesn't like to be called that, because he'll tell you a very different story. But he was, the Air Force Academy just didn't recognize him as an A-plus student, but he really was when he was a cadet. So anyway, General Steve Lorenz was a retired four-star general. I did some research, and of 100 second lieutenants that are commissioned as officers in the Air Force, 26 make lieutenant colonel, 8 make full colonel like I did, 1 out of the 100 makes one-star general, 4-star general is like some little minute fraction of 1%, whatever that is. So he's the creme de la creme. He's run organizations that have almost 100,000 people. What? AETC had 88,000 people. I mean, can you imagine being in charge of 88,000 people? Yeah, I mean, okay. Anyway, but this guy did it. But he's a pilot, combat-ready pilot. He's a leader. And he was also the best boss I ever had in my whole professional career. And the thing I liked best is that I always knew that he was telling me the truth, even if it was not fun for me to hear the truth. Think of your parents. Yes, Ava, sometimes the truth hurts. But yeah, but she's trying to help you. And he always would say, Mark, think about this, or what were you thinking, or what, and he was always there for me, and he supported me and my program, which was character and leadership development at the Air Force Academy. He had lots of other things to think about. Mine was just one, but I always knew he was there for me, and that's what people want from a boss. It's not someone that comes in and bosses you around every day. No. How can I help you do your job? So anyway, I could keep going on and on. But I know General Lorenzo is going to talk about leadership. He's going to tell a lot of stories. But here's one thing. He has a book that he wrote. If you want his book, let's say you kind of like what he says today. Let Mr. Cross know that you want the book. He's going to put together a list, and then Mrs. Hurley and I will figure out how to go get that book and get it to you. How's that sound? Air University Press, right? Sir, here it is.
Okay. Do I do it with this? Or? Okay. Well, hello, everybody, and it's an honor and privilege to be here. I have a briefing on all sorts of subjects on leadership, and some of them will be high up there, but I'm going to talk to them and tell you about thinking. So sit back. There's no test on this. Relax, okay, and enjoy, and there'll be some videos and stuff there and the like. So next slide, please. Let's see if this works. All right. This is probably my favorite quote in the whole world. It's by Winston Churchill. How many of you know I've studied Winston Churchill? Raise your hand. Okay, he was Prime Minister of England during World War II. Anyway, to every person, there comes in their lifetime that special moment when they are tapped on the shoulder and offered a chance to do a very special thing unique to them, talents, and fitted to their talents. What a tragedy if that moment finds them unprepared and unqualified for the work that would be their finest hour. The thing about Churchill is literally he failed at so many things in his life. Everybody thinks of all the great things he did, which he did, but like, for instance, in 1899, the Boer War's going on, and he goes down and becomes a prisoner of war there, but he runs for Parliament in 1899. He loses. He comes back in 1900 and wins, first time he ever did. He tried everything. During the 20s and 30s, he starts railing against this guy in Germany, Adolf Hitler. How many of you studied Adolf Hitler? Anybody? Okay, very good. Well, it was not very popular to do that. And because he was railing against Nazi Germany, and the national strategy of England at the time was appeasement of Adolf Hitler. And appeasement meaning we'll just keep him happy, all right? There was a prime minister named Neville Chamberlain, and he wanted to appease Hitler. Well, at the height, in 1940, at the height of this, Neville Chamberlain has to resign, and Winston Churchill, he wasn't even the first choice, but they make him prime minister, and he leads the British people in the British Empire through World War II from 1940 to 1945, and he saves the empire, but at the height of his powers in 1945, he's at Potsdam, which was a place where they were negotiating with the Russians. It's funny how things go round and round, but negotiating, and Stalin was there. He was the leader of the Russians, and he was there. Churchill, leader of the British, and Truman, who was our president at the time, were there. And at the height of his powers, Winston Churchill's powers, the British people have an election, and they vote him out of office. He has to literally get up from the table and leave the table, and the new prime minister comes in. Then he's, in 1950, he's re-elected prime minister. In 1955, he leaves being prime minister. He never gave up, he never gave up, he never gave up. This is an important concept, okay? The only difference between, this your son and your mom is scar tissue, because you've lived longer than they have, all right? And I'm going to use this as a metaphor. There's a road of life. And on that road of life, there's 100 bumps, okay? And you walk down this road. If you don't talk to anybody who's been down the road before, like your mom and dad or your older brother and sister, okay, you're bound to hit all 100 bumps. But if you talk to your mom or your dad or your grandfather, okay, and you talk to them about what their journey down the road of life is, maybe you only hit 80% of the bumps. And that's certainly better than hitting 100% of the bumps. So, by the way, what do people like to talk about? Themselves, okay? So if you go ask anybody and ask them, what do you think about this or that? If you're asking their opinion, they will answer it, because people like to talk about themselves. So use that as a technique to get more information about going down the road of life, okay? And it's amazing. So I'll tell you a story about me. I'm third generation Air Force. My dad was in the Air Force, and I went to 13 different schools, 4 different high schools, okay, 4. And so my dad brought me down here. He was stationed at Lowry up in Denver, which doesn't exist anymore. And he showed me the Air Force Academy in 1960, which is in the Wayback Machine, a long, long time ago. And I don't know why, but at 9 years old, I said, this is where I want to go to school. And so for the next umpty-ump moves, I've moved 30 times in my life, if you count the two of them together, I focused on going to the Air Force Academy. And so when I was a senior in high school, I was in Upper Marlboro, Maryland, and outside Washington, and I applied to go to the academy, and I literally walked the halls of Congress and got an appointment, and I got in. Well, the hard part for me was not getting in. The hard part for me was staying there. You see, all those different schools, I didn't have the foundation in which to build a good academic achievement record. I liked aeronautical engineering, electrical engineering, and computer science so much, I took them twice. I was on the dean's other list 6 of 8 semesters. Okay? That means I slugged my way through the school. Okay? And I was very fortunate I did get to graduate. And so that's why I learned from him, never give up, never give up, never give up. Okay? You take the 2x4s in the face, you dust yourself up, and you keep moving forward. Okay? You're all going to face adversity. That's part of life. And how you handle it is what is important. So never give up, never give up, never give up. Okay? By the way, in the infinite wisdom of the Air Force, as Mark said, I was a university president, Air University in Montgomery, Alabama, and also the commander of Air Education and Training Command, so I ran all the education in the Air Force. Go figure. Anyway, life is full of ironies. Never give up, never give up, never give up. Next slide. So, I'm going to tell you these things, and I'm going to talk in level. Here's one that I learned, a principle of leadership. Learn the art of balancing shortfalls, because you never have enough time, money, and manpower. Now, see, I thought this up originally, but this is the scarcity principle. Okay, how many of you have enough time to study all the stuff and do the things you want to do? Nobody does. Your mom and dads don't. They have to balance. It's about balance. And so the issue is, and more you get older, and by moms and dads, you have enough money? Okay, all right. Do you have enough, when Mark Hyatt's putting this all together, does he have enough manpower to make it come true? No. So you will do this the rest of your life, whether you said you were in eighth grade, okay? Whether you're in, no? Sixth grade, I'm sorry. Whether you're in sixth grade or you're a retired pensioner on a fixed income, you just, you balance these things. It's called the scarcity principle, all right? So time, money, manpower. Okay, next slide, please.
See if this is tomorrow, so let's make sure we all know our usual responsibilities. Jeff, you keep feeding me old information. Dean, I need you to continue not living up to your resume. Sue, you're in charge of waffling.
Are you sure?
Jerome, you'll talk a big game, then do nothing.
Let's do it.
Rick, can you fold under pressure for me?
Like a lawn chair.
And Ted, you just keep thinking everyone's out to get you.
They are.
I'll be at FedEx Kinko's, where they'll help me design, print, copy, and finish the proposal.
Put your presentations together at FedEx Kinko's. Make it, print it, pack it, ship it. Our office is your office.
You will see some videos that will make a point of reinforcing. So scarcity principle, remember that. Rest of your life. Time, money, manpower. Okay, next slide, please. Ooh, this one is the toughest word to say in the English language is yes. Most people think the toughest word to say in the English language is no. Okay, uh-uh. If I'm balancing shortfalls all the time, let's say I have, mom, I have 10 things to do today, okay? And someone, they come in and say, I've got to go to school for study hall or something, and that makes it 11. And you already had prioritized all the things you were going to do, and now you have 11 things. And you go, your initial reaction is to say no. That's human nature, say no. So what I do is, like for instance, when I had a bunch of lawyers working for me, JAGs, they're called Judge Advocate General, I made them, they could never say yes, they could never say no. They had to say, let me look into that. And when they did, they would always find a solution. So the rest of your life, you're going to be balancing these shortfalls. And so sometimes a friend's going to come and ask you to do something, and you've got all these other things to do, and your initial reaction is to say no. Pause, breathe through your nose, think about it, reprioritize the things, and you probably can most of the time say yes. Okay, but you got to think about it. Okay, next slide.
Now we're going to run a few tests. This is a simple lie detector. I'll ask you a few yes or no questions, and you just answer truthfully. Do you understand?
Yes.
Okay, who is that?
Homer.
Homer Simpson, right? Okay, always remember that everything is generational. It's all off the year you're born, and you have no say in that. None. If you're born 10 years earlier or 10 years later, it starts your shared common experiences of that. So my father, who passed away about 3 years ago, if I showed that video to him, he was born in 1925, he would know who Homer Simpson was, okay? And so you do, and everything is generational. So what you need to do is, when you are dealing with, everything's cross-generational. Okay, and as I said, everything's off the year you're born. So if you want to relate to your mom, you need to find things that she, as a shared common experience that she had, you know, like Homer Simpson, okay? Something like, yes, because that's what she does with you. She watches TV or this and watches you, and you know a heck of a lot more of what's going on today, but what about her? And I'm not picking on you, I'm just saying. What about, I'll pick on him or him. As a shared common experience, you have to have a shared common experience to be cross-generational, you know, that they will understand. You need to tell a story or something to make a point in something that they will, that the other generation will understand. By the way, throughout history, the younger generation is always going downhill. I would use another word, but that I can't do that here. But that's not true. The answer is you're just learning different experiences. And by the way, when you were that age, your parents thought that same thing. It's all generational. That's right. All right, next slide, please. New ideas like planting a tree must be given and nurtured so that they can grow and bear fruit. Okay? So if you're balancing shortfalls, I keep coming back to that, and you're trying to advocate something in your, like, let's say, among your brothers and sisters with your mom and dad, I want a new something or other. Okay? Wow. It usually is a zero-sum game because they don't have, your mom and dad or don't have the money to pay for this or pay for that or to take care of it. So, but if you come up with a new idea, go out and start selling it. Go out and advocate for it. Mom, dad, I need a computer or whatever the heck it is. And so it's amazing what happens. Next slide, please. So see this picture? This picture was in 1972. Look at that. Look at all those. That's my generation. Look at all that hair. Okay? See? All right? And so would you invest in that, in those people? Would you invest in them? Next slide, please. So who's that? That kid right there. That's Bill Gates. Probably one of, if not the, no, I don't think he's the richest man, but he must be number two or three. Look at that. He was about a little bit older than you, but look at that. So would you invest in that? No. So just remember. Next slide. As a leader, you must reach the acceptance stage of grief faster than the people you lead or in your family. And by the way, everybody has, goes through the five stages of grief at one time or another. And if you're going to lead the family through something, you need to get through the stages before they get to it. Okay? I'll tell a story. I was a wing commander at March Air Force Base in Riverside, California. It was flew big airplanes and stuff, and we had an operational readiness inspection, ORI, come and visit. And a team of 150 people came and inspected everything on the base. Okay? And I had only been the wing commander for like 7 weeks. And so the wing worked very, very hard towards a common goal. And by the way, in an operational readiness inspection, they give you a grade: outstanding, excellent, satisfactory, marginal, unsatisfactory. And everybody wants to get the highest grade they can get. By the way, the same thing in going to school, right? You want to get the highest grade that you can get. Well, anyway, so we worked very, very hard as a team. We did a great job. And I'll never forget this. So they have a methodology where they bring in the wing commander and they pre-brief him about what the grade was. And then you all go to the movie theater on base, and there are seats for 400 and there are 700 people there. And they're all excited because they've worked very hard and they want to get a good grade. Well, the DOD, the IG, the Inspector General, who this was 20 some odd years, almost 30 years ago, and he said, Lorenz, your wing did very, very well, but you get a high satisfactory. Okay? They were expecting an excellent or an outstanding. Well, I was very disappointed, and I had to go to lead my team through. I had to go through the five stages of grief. So I went out to a B-52 on a stick, and I yelled at it for 30 minutes to get it out of my system. What could I do? Should I yell at my deputies or my chiefs, my NCOs? No, I yelled at it. So we go in the room like this, and there's horns going off because it's like a pep rally. And they go and they brief, and they go, you did well, you did well, you get a satisfactory. You did well, you did well, you get a satisfactory. And by the time they get through briefing, everybody knows we're going to get a satisfactory, which is passing, but it's not what they wanted. And I'll never forget by the time we got to when they figured out what the grade was, all the air had been sucked out of the room. The noisemakers stopped. It was dead silence. So all the senior officers get up and say, hey, you all did a good job, and they all leave. So I'm left as the commander holding the bag. So I stand up in front of them, and there's a camera filming me. I'll never forget this. And so I thought about what I was going to say, and I said, you know, the IG team, the Inspector General team that came through and inspected us, were made up of very good people and very professional. And I said, and we're a better unit because they came. But I tell you what I think. I think the grade we got was the biggest bunch of blank. And all of a sudden it was dead silence. And then the entire, everybody stood up and cheered and horns went off because I said what they were thinking. Okay, the only problem with that, and this is where you got to think things through, is I forgot that they had filmed me. And so we had a big party at the club to celebrate the end of the ORI, and in every room was a TV with a on a do loop, and it says the greatest, the greatest, the greatest. And by the way, you got to be careful because I run the Falcon Foundation today, and the gentleman who was at the time a brigadier general, and I was a colonel. I'm the president of the Falcon Foundation, and he's the guy who gave me the greatest, the chairman. So I get to work with him now 30 years later. All right, next slide. So always remember the five stages of grief, okay? Next slide, please. Oh, don't lose your temper unless you plan to. How many people have ever lost your temper and felt bad about it after it happened? How many of you? All right. When I was a captain many, many, many years ago, I was an aide de camp, to a four-star general named Bryce Poe, a great American. He's passed away now. Wonderful leader, wonderful person. He never lost his cool. Well, one day I'm a captain, and I'm sitting at the back there where the door was, and there's a staff, and there's 3 stars and 2 stars and 1 stars and colonels and chief mass sergeants sitting around, and some briefer gets up and starts briefing. And at first, General Poe was listening. Then he started sounding very short. And then he wasn't smiling anything, and he never did stuff like this. He's always nice. And then he started pounding on the table. And finally, after about a couple of minutes, he says, "I can't take anymore," and he stands up. And of course, we all pop too. And the briefer's standing there against the wall, going, "What the heck happened?" And so he says, "I can't take anymore." And he starts to walk out the door. I get the door. I'm the captain. He walks through, and I walk in parallel with him down the hallway. But I stay about 10 feet away because I didn't want to get killed in the frag pattern. And he turns to me and winks and he says, "Sometimes you do things for effect." He wasn't mad at all. He was making a point. In other words, he hadn't lost his temper. And so that's why I say, don't lose your temper, moms, dads, don't lose your temper unless you plan to, because you want to have an effect. How many times have you been hanging around people who lose their temper a lot? Well, after a while, it loses its credibility, doesn't it? Or are you just pointing at him? Okay. All right, just checking. All right, but so this is just a technique on how to deal with people, all right? Next slide.
What, you don't like the way I drive? Why'd you come on in here? I'll give you a driving
lesson. I didn't know.
You want a piece of me? Why don't you come out and get you some, huh? Where are you going to go now? Well, you can't speed up by anybody now. You think you're better than me?
At Suburban, you'll find revolutionary ideas that other dealerships just don't offer.
Keep out!
Suburban Auto Group on Highway 26 in Sandy. Trunk monkey pending approval by Attorney General.
All right, back in the trunk.
In olden days, there were lots of trunk monkey commercials. Okay, next slide. Ah, here's one. This is tough to learn, because everybody gets emotional about when they have an idea, and it's all about them. The more objective you are, the more effective you are. Okay? And, you know, it's 10 times, a lot of people today, and it's always been throughout this generational, is want to give you your opinion. the most powerful thing is when somebody asks your opinion. It's very influential because they're listening. Now, you know, I enjoy watching the news every day, and I like to watch panels where they have four or five people with different opinions. There's nothing I enjoy more than when I go like this, and somebody says something, I said, I wish I had thought of that. I enjoy that when I learn something new or think of something in a different way than I did before. And by the way, it's awfully tough today, okay? And so always remember, the more objective you are, the more effective you are. And your job is in life is to be effective, Mom, okay? You want the technique that you use to be effective and have the effect that you want. And so it's and half the time we all get emotional on stuff, and that's understandable. But try and not put your ego where your position is. Colin Powell said this. I worked for him many, many years ago. He passed away recently. If you put your ego where your position is, when your position goes, your ego goes with it. So just technique, not procedure. Next slide, please. This is sort of grainy. It's a Dutch quote.
Mix a mess of murder, you love some heavy water. See the Mellorooney come out, slurp, slurp, slurp. Who wants a bucket of cement?
Okay, sorry, just anyway. Next slide, please. All right, here's one. And by the way, you don't have any bosses, but you will, but it's also a way of thinking. There was this guy named Clausewitz, and he would think he described three levels of thinking: tactical, operational, and strategic. Well, one way I think of that is I always, throughout your life, the rest of your life, after you graduate, you're gonna have a boss. But your boss has a boss. So always look two levels above yourself, okay? Two levels above yourself. If your boss's boss is happy with your boss is happy with you. And see these two people? That's Norty Schwartz. He was chief of staff of the Air Force. He's my classmate. And then Donnelly, who was secretary. So I would always look through the eyes of Secretary Donnelly. And if Donnelly was happy with Schwartz, Schwartz was happy with me. Just a way of thinking, a technique. By the way, it was the same thing with school teachers. And like you, there's a strata here, isn't there, of teacher and then above principal, see superintendent, all that stuff. So just look through the eyes, think big, think strategically, think big. All right, next slide. Study. I write down study the profession. I was in the military, so I read military history. Those who don't, okay, you like history, good. Okay, those who don't study the past are condemned to repeat it. That's not original with me, by the way, okay? And so I always would read what people, remember I talked about the road of life? Read what other people have done before you. If you're a baseball player, you like to play baseball or something, read about baseball players, or hockey, or basketball, or teachers, study. Don't worry, you'll make it through, okay? Good, it's okay. I'll keep you awake, all right? Anyway. So the answer is study other people because they've been down the road of life before you. It's amazing. Why make up all the stuff and have to learn? And you don't want to have as much scar tissue as I have. Okay, learn from other people. Next slide. Oh, this is never develop a sense of entitlement. I'm not gonna. These are two old. One's a congressman and one's a undersecretary of the Air Force. It doesn't matter. But everybody, I'm going to talk to you about entitled. We're entitled to something. We're not entitled to anything, except there are three things that affect you the rest of your life, okay? Three things: timing, luck, and hard work. It's amazing what happens to people. If you keep showing up, I say that again and again, timing, luck, and hard work. And so the answer is you can control. You can't control timing. You can't control luck. But you can control hard work. Never, ever, ever give up. See how it's all intertied in together? Okay? All right. Next slide. All right. This one, moms and dads, I'm sorry, but this is an important concept. Okay? For real. Whether you are a teenager or 70 or 80 or whatever it is, throughout history, these are the four things that get people in trouble, or a combination thereof: booze, sex, drugs, or money. Okay, you're going, what the heck, what's he talking about? As you get older, I promise you, okay? I always used to say that the cadets out there who were 18, 17, stuff like that, how many drinks did that take to become a good decision? And by the way, why are your moms and dads laughing at it? Because they've been there, done that, and they have the T-shirt. So why make a mistake? Don't do the same things, okay? I'm telling you, you see it on TV, you see it on the news, you see it everywhere. People get in trouble over those four things, all right? All right. Next slide, please.
The boys are calling crazy girl.
I hope she sings this tonight.
I know.
Hey, Dad, pull over. We need to go.
I'm on it.
Oh, honey?
Here's some money.
What do we got here? I love it.
Sorry. All right. By the way, perceptions are as good as reality.
I'm her daddy.
Okay? So always stay in the straight and narrow. I bet you your moms and dads teach you values that they lived their whole life. Listen to them. Okay? And by the way, I know it gets tiring, doesn't it? Especially when you go see your friends. But listen to the core values your mom and dad teach, and your grandfather, your grandparents teach you. They've been down the road. They have more scar tissue than you do, and it'll make it easier in your life. All right? Next slide. All right? Never going to know when you make a difference. Here's one of my heroes, Colin Powell, chairman of the Joint Chiefs Staff. I was three levels below him, but I never forget this. I was in his office and delivering a paper to his executive officer or something. I can't remember. And there's this major, he was an Army major, standing there, and next to him is this this lady, and she had spandex pants, powdered blue, double-knit blouse, silver blue hair, okay? And at that very moment, the major goes, "Grandma, that's General Powell's office." And at the very moment, the door flies open, General Powell has a paper in his hand, he's deep in thought, he puts the paper down, he looks up, and he sees the major, and he sees the grandmother. He says, "Major, is this your grandmother?" And the major puffs up with pride and goes, "Yes, sir, it is." And so he comes over, gingerly shakes the grandmother's hand, and starts to profusely tell the grandmother how great her major grandson was and how he could not do his job without all of the hard work that her grandson was doing. He reaches in and finds a coin and gives the grandmother and says, "I just want to tell you again how great your grandson is." Okay, I looked over, and there's the grandmother passed out on the floor. No, she wasn't, but her eyes were big as saucers. So in milliseconds, Powell got out of his head and to other people's heads and made a difference in their lives. By the way, about 20 years later after this happened, some Air Force guy comes up and says, "Sir, do you still tell that story about General Powell and the grandmother?" And I said, "Yeah." He says, "That's my great-grandmother, and my grandfather, and my father tells that story." So you never know. You never know when you're going to make a difference. Next slide. Okay. All right, I'm going to tell some stories. I was Commandant of Cadets at the Air Force Academy for 3 years. That's when Mike Hyatt and I worked together. And I'll never forget that it was the class of 2000, which is way earlier on, okay? This young lady, I'll never forget, she went up to have training in the mountains, and she passed away. She had got sick, and we hardly ever lost anyone up there. So we had the funeral in the cadet chapel, okay? And I'll never forget this. There's the mom and the dad. They've given us their national treasure, their daughter. So I steel myself. What does one say as a person to the mom, the dad? And I'll never forget, I went up and said, "Ma'am, my name's Steve," and she cuts me off cold. The mom does. She says, "I know who you are, General. One day you were walking down the trot, so that's where all the cadets formed up, and you saw my daughter. And she had just earned a pin which said she had great grades, superintendent's pin. And you walked up to her and said, Cadet, that pin looks good on you." And she says, "My daughter thanked you," and then she turned around and ran back to the room and called me and said, "Guess what? The commandant just congratulated me on getting the superintendent's pin." I don't remember this event at all, but that's what the mom remembered. You never know when you're going to make a difference, okay? You never know. Next slide. Go to the next one, please. Okay, being in our profession, the military, and also going to school here, especially under Colonel Hyatt, it's about service to others. In the Air Force, the core values are integrity, service, and excellence. I would go down and... I went to Iraq, and I was in Balad, the base there, the big one. And I'll never forget, I ran into this chief master sergeant. He's a very senior NCO in the Air Force. And this little baby, you can see him holding, his family has, at the time, been killed. And the baby is wounded. And the chief has two kids at home in the States, and he's there. And the baby will not stop crying. So one day at the end of his work day, he comes and he holds the baby, and he sleeps there in the chair with the baby and rocks it till it goes to sleep. He didn't do this one day, one night. He did it for 5 nights in a row. You never know when you're going to make a difference, okay? You never know. Next slide. Okay. This one is this old story, but a leader is responsible for self, people, and results. By the way, you're responsible for the example you set and how you live your life, okay? As you get and you hang out with your friends, you're also responsible for the people that you hang around with. And then results. As a leader, you can't always guarantee that. Let me just tell a quick story here. Next slide, please. This is from the Wall Street Journal in 1952. There was a Navy carrier and a small destroyer. They were in maneuvers in the middle of the night, and the ship turns. They give a wrong order, the captain does, and they collide. All right, next slide, please. And the bow of the ship, 176 people died, including the captain. And the captain was of the destroyer, is very well respected. Anyway, this thing, accountability. By the way, accountability here in the school. Accountability in this church. Accountability is so important. It's transparent. But this is what they wrote. By the way, it talks about men, but that's 1952. It's men and women, okay? Accountability is not for attention, but for the dead. The captain of a ship, like the captain of state, is given honor and privileges and trust beyond other people. That, by the way, teachers get trust, okay? All right? Principals get trust. But let them steer the wrong course. Let them touch ground. Let them bring disaster to the ship and his or her men, and men or women, and he must answer for what he has done. No matter what, they cannot escape. It is cruel, this accountability of good and well-intentioned people. So you have to hold people accountable. Even when you're at your age, studying for tests, not cheating, be accountable, okay? Next slide. All right. I tell you what, we'll go through this one. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. Okay. I was a squadron commander, in fact, back then in the olden days, and I thought I was a very good squadron commander. And I had about 150 people working for me at the time. Well, when I was the commander of Air Education Training Command, I would go visit different units. And I ran into this security forces major. He was a major, prior enlisted. And I thought I was the best, but he was better. He was a major, and I saw it. I'd go around his squadron, and there were pictures of all of his troops all over the walls while they deployed. They were all deployed. And so he had, now, servant leaders, see this pyramid? That's AETC commander, that's me, then numbered Air Forces and wing commanders and group commanders of squadron. Next slide. he took all of his charts, his line charts about his squadron, and he put himself on the bottom and all of his troops on the top. I thought to myself, what a great technique to demonstrate servant leadership. All right? Servant leaders work for their people. If you're going to become captain of a baseball team or a basketball or hockey, okay, you're there to serve others, not yourself. Always remember that. It's tough. Okay, but that's what it's all about. Next slide. All right. As a leader, it takes courage to apologize when you're wrong. How many of you have made mistakes in front of your friends and stuff, and you wish you'd, you know, you have to have moral courage to apologize. Let me use this. This is General Bill Looney. I replaced him as the commander of ATC. By the way, what do you think his nickname is? Tunes. Looney Tunes. Everybody calls him Tunes, okay? Anyway, he's retired now. He went and gave a briefing to a med group, a medical group, in a room just like this. And he gets up on the stage, and there's a colonel sitting there, a doctor, sitting there like where you're sitting, and he has a computer. And he opens it up while he starts speaking, and the colonel's typing. And he gets, and this is at the beginning of his briefing, and he goes, hey, colonel, pay attention. What I got to say is important to you, okay? And the colonel goes like this and shuts the thing. And, of course, when somebody does something like that, everybody else turns off. There's no dead silence. So he gives his speech. Anybody have any questions? Of course, they're not going to ask any questions after that. And so they all start walking out. Well, the colonel, General Looney, starts to walk out to get to his staff car, and the colonel runs him down and says, General, I wasn't trying to be disrespectful. I am the doctor who's in command of the emergency room, and none of my people can be here. So I had my computer out, and I was typing down the things that you're going to say so I could debrief them and tell him what you said. Bill says,
yeah.
This is how he felt. So everybody's leaving. He says, everybody back in their seats. And they all got back up, and he gets on the stage. He says, I want to apologize to the colonel in front of everybody. He was right, and I was wrong. It's very tough to apologize. I'm just telling you, you have to have moral courage to do it. Next slide. Everyone can be a leader and example to others. I would go visit the Center for the Intrepid in San Antonio where the wounded were coming back from the war. And I will never forget, I went in to see a Sergeant Olson. He had been injured by an IED, a bomb, and his arm was in a cast with a metal bar here and screws through his arm. And he's sitting there, and I think it was about 4 in the afternoon. And the next morning at 7:30, he was going to have a major operation and take all the screws and everything out. And I said, Sergeant Olson, is there anything I can do for you? And he goes, General, my dog, Blick, was injured when I was injured when the bomb went off. He's not doing well. Could you help me retire him and help me adopt him? What do you say to that? What do you say? Of course. Well, after I retired, I went down, and I'll never forget, I went down to Montgomery, Alabama, to Air University, and I was going to give a speech, and I heard that Sergeant Olson was there. And so I go up to the cage where the dogs are all kept, and it's a chain link fence, and I rattle, and a staff sergeant comes out. Yeah, what do you want? I said, is there a dog named Blick here? He says, that couch potato? He's so fat now that he's retired. So I went in and I saw, that's a picture of Blick, Sergeant Olson, and I. You got to take care of the people. And what a leader he was. Next slide. All right. This was in 09, and I'm sitting in my office in San Antonio, and I hear that there's been a shooting up in at Shepherd Air Force Base, off base. So, and three of my NCOs, this is one of them, is wounded. So I get in my T1, and I fly up. And what happened was some crazy guy, and you read about it in the news, you see it today, that there's some came in shooting, and he eventually was taken care of. But my two of my NCOs were wounded, and they flew him to Dallas. And I went into the emergency room where they were operating, and one was just come out, and the other one was being operated on. And so this is Staff Sergeant Jade Henderson. She's laying there. She's just been operated on. I said, Sergeant Anderson, you have the entire weight and might of 332,000 airmen behind you. What can we do for you? Now, picture this lady's just been operated on. She's still under sedation and stuff. She grabs my hand, squeezes it as tight as she can, and she says, "General, don't take my training slot away. I want to become a medical technician." What do you say to that? Anyway, so we worked it. She got to go back into training, become a medical technician. About 5 or 6 years later, I ran into her at off at Air Force Base, and there she was working in the hospital. All right, next slide. Here's another one, and by moms and dad, I don't mean that these are all challenging issues. This is Jessica Tarver, 24 years old. She goes to Iraq twice. She serves. She catches some sort of an infection. They bring her to the hospital. I go meet her. They've had to amputate both of her legs below the knee. About 6 months later, I come back to visit her. She's doing her thing. Then I hear that she passes away. The infection has come back. So I go to the funeral. There are 70 seats for 75. There are 200 seats. So this, I'll never forget, we're all sitting there, and this crusty old Army major who was a physical therapist gets up and he starts talking about Jessica Tarver, Senior Airman Tarver, said, "You know, I teach people to walk in prosthetics in tennis shoes. Jessica wanted to walk in 6-inch heels. We got her up to 4-inch heels before she passed away." So she's a leader, a sets the example. We're, I mean, just phenomenal people. Next slide. All right, I got, this is video. It's from an old movie. I want you to watch the body language. It's about setting an example and what you can do just by being the best you can be playing sports or whatever it is, okay? Next slide, please.
Come here, Brock. You too, Jeremy.
What, am I in trouble now?
Not yet. I want to see you do the death crawl again, except I want to see your absolute best.
What, you want me to go to the 30?
I think you can go to the 50.
50. I can go to the 50 if nobody's on my back.
I think you can do it with Jeremy on your back. But even if you can, I want you to promise me you're going to do your best.
All right.
Your best.
Okay.
You going to give me your best?
I'm going to give you my best.
All right, one more thing. I want you to do it blindfolded.
Why?
Because I don't want you giving up at a certain point when you can go further. Get down. Jeremy, get on his back. Get a good tight hold, Jeremy. All right, let's go, Brock. Keep your knees off the ground, just your hands and feet. There you go. A little bit left, a little bit left. There you go. Show me good effort. That way, Brock. You keep coming. There you go. It's a good start. A little bit left, a little bit left. There you go, Brock. Good strength. That's it, Brock. That's it.
Am I at the 20 yet?
Forget the 20. You give me your best. You keep going. That's it. No.
It hurts.
Don't quit on me. Your very best. Keep driving. Keep driving. There you go. There you go.
He's heavy.
I know he's heavy.
I'm by out of strength.
Then you negotiate with your body to find more strength, but don't you give up on me, Brock. You keep going. You hear me? You keep going. You're doing good. You keep going. Do not quit on me. You keep going.
It hurts.
I know it hurts. You keep going. You keep going. It's all hard from here. 30 more steps. You keep going, Brock. Come on. Keep going.
Burn.
And let it burn.
My arms are burning.
It's all hard. You keep going, Brock. Come on. Come on. Keep going. You promised me your best. Your best. Don't stop. Keep going.
Too hard.
It's not too hard. You keep going. Come on, Brock. Give me more. Give me more! Keep going! 20 more steps! 20 more! Keep going, Brock! Give me your best! Don't quit! No! Keep going! Keep going! Keep going! Don't quit! Don't quit! Don't quit! Brock Kelly, you don't quit! Keep going! Keep going! No, Brock Kelly! You don't quit on me! No! You keep going! You keep going! Go, Brock! 10 more steps! 10 more! 10 more! 10 more! Keep going! Don't quit! Give me your arm!
I can't do it!
You can! You can! 5 more! 5 more! Come on, Brock! Come on! Don't quit! Don't quit! Come on, Brock! Two more! One more!
It's got to be 50. It's got to be 50. I don't have any more.
Look up, Brock. You're in the end zone. Brock, you are the most influential player on this team. If you walk around defeated, so will they. Don't tell me you can't give me more than what I've been seeing. You just carried a 140-pound man across this whole field in your arms. Brock, I need you. God's gifted you with the ability of leadership. Don't waste it.
Coach?
Can I count on you? Yes.
In so many ways, that's a metaphor of life. Don't quit. Don't quit. Never give up. Never give up. One final slide. I can't. I have this on my desk, and my daughter gave this to me. My deepest fear is I look back on my life and wonder what I did with it. So here you are in school, going, learning through this school and with your moms and dads. Pick it all up. Give it your best shot. Playing. How many of you play soccer? Okay, how many of you play baseball? Okay, hockey? Okay, basketball? Okay, give it your all, no matter what. Study, study, study. Learn from others, okay? All right, that's all I got, unless you want to ask some questions. Go ahead, on any subject. Yes?
How did he do that?
Well, it was very tough, but it's a movie. Okay. So it's just an example of never give up, never give up, never give up, okay? Good question. All right, any other questions? Nothing? Everybody's happy, huh? Must be lunch hour. Okay. All right, well, listen, it's an honor and privilege to be here, and thank you for letting me talk to you all, and wish you all the best, moms and dads. Hang in there, grandfathers, hang in there, and wish you all the best.
Okay, thank you so much, General Lorenz. Thank you. Yep, here we go. You know, there's an old saying, and I'm not sure where it came from. If you save one child, you save the whole world. You've saved a lot. Thank you. And there's a lot, some of you have heard a lot of my sayings, but when you're old ladies and old men, you're going to come back and you're going to help young people be just like him, me, Mrs. Hurley, Mr. Cross, and everybody else. That's our goal, is to try to pass this baton in the relay race of life. And your job is to learn, and your parents' job is to earn, and our job is to return. And that's what we're doing for you. So thank you, sir. Okay, it's over.